Hello, sir. Hi, a warm welcome to you. So, can you tell us about your startup and about yourself?
All right. So, my name is Jitendra Chokse. I come from a small village called Pulaha. I was a technical consultant. I worked with different companies. I worked with IBM. I worked with L&T as an SAP ERP consultant. And I was during my journey in the IT industry, I worked with different projects, Luxottica, L'Oreal, HP Merck. So I worked with different kind of projects, and I've been a health and fitness enthusiast for almost 20 years. I was fat when I was a kid, so I started into fitness early on, just wanted to get fit. I didn't get fit, but I got into good habits, right? And Fitter was accidental. I was not trying to create a company or anything. Around 2013, I started posting my fitness, pictures and all those things on social media. And I was also covered by Men's Health magazine. So because of that, a lot of people saw my pictures and then they wanted me to train them. So I created a small WhatsApp group and I started giving them, diet and nutrition and fitness tips. So the concept was very simple, quantified nutrition plus resistance training. And these people, once they started getting results, they told others, and the word got out, and soon I was being chased by hundreds of people from all the world. And I said, okay, this is too much. Maybe I have to create a better way of doing this. So I created a Facebook group and put all my details in a condensed form in a book called Get Shredded and posted it on a social media, on the Facebook group called Squats back then. I posted that on Squats, and because of that, we created a huge community of people who were constantly discussing, asking questions. I was answering their questions. And so, because of this whole Q&A and people discussing about fitness and nutrition, it became a thriving community. And people were getting results. So when people were getting results, they were adding more people. By December 2015, we had almost 50,000 people in that community. There was a recurring theme. All this information was available free of cost. There was no business idea on mind. I was not thinking of monetizing. I was working with my emphasis at that point of time. I was working in emphasis at that point of time. So I had no ideas of creating a business. But I saw that there was a common theme between all the people who were joining the community and wanted me to help them. They wanted me to personally train them. And I thought, this is difficult because there are so many people. How can I personally train so many of you guys? They said, it's fine, you train us, we'll pay you more money. And I didn't want to do it for money because it was something which I was doing for fun. I loved it, right? So then I came across this idea. The idea was simple, like Amazon and Flipkart are selling products. Why can't we sell services of coaches in a trustworthy, accountable, tangible format, wherein if people select a coach, make them fit, they pay the money. And if they are not happy with the results, they will get their entire money. And one of my friends, collected 90,000 rupees from the initial stakeholders. There were six initial stakeholders. Using that money, we developed the first website. And in the first month itself, we were profitable. We had 14 coaches to start with. And I think we got around 139 customers in first month. After that, we just used all of it month after month after month. And almost 4.5 years. Now we have 220 plus coaches all over the world. We have trained over 120,000 people, roughly 120,000 people. And we have done a cumulative gross revenue of over 100 crores. And our monthly revenues are typically north of $500,000. We are always profitable. And we had bootstrapped our way from 90,000 rupees to 100 crores. First, we got selected in Y Combinator in January. Which I quit because I didn't like it. And then later on, we also got into Sequoia Search. So they have also funded $2 million.
That's really an amazing insight that you gave us today. So I would just like to ask you if you could tell us more about your app. You recently launched an app, right? Fitter. If you could tell us, throw some light on the same, and how is it that your fitness app and your startup is very different? It makes you stand apart from the crowd. Since today we have a number of fitness apps which are there.
I think one of the biggest thing about the app is that it was evolved a period of, it was not something which we conceptualized. it was not my brainchild. It was more of a concept which came from the end users. So we were always listening what people are looking for. When we created, when we launched the fitter community, the goal was one, making people fit. People started getting fit. That's why people joined, more people, right? Then they said, you know, maybe we need personal trainers to help us become fit. Until then, there were no concept of personal coaching. So I said, okay, you need personal coaches. This is probably a better way to do a personal coaching. Why do you want to waste your money if you are not getting any kind of guarantee? So we introduced a scheme where you get 100% refund if you're not satisfied, right? So that was also an outcome of what exactly the customers were looking for at that point of time. Then people said, you know what, Facebook group is messy. You know, why don't we have something like Facebook group on our own platform? Because I don't want to use Facebook, but I still want all the information that you guys are sharing on Facebook group. I said, okay, that's an interesting idea. How about we create our own social media platform? That was how we created the Fitter app. Then people said, you know, it would be a good idea if you can also provide us free diet and training plans. I said, okay, let's do that. Then they said, it would be a great idea if it also has recipes. So we asked people to start uploading recipes. And now we have almost 5,000 recipes of healthy foods. People said, we need workouts. I said, okay, take workouts. So anything and everything that people have asked, Fitter app is a culmination of that. So today we are constantly listening. If people are saying, hey, JC, there's this one thing which is not allowing me to get fixed, I focus on that one thing and fix that. So that you know, you're always listening to your customers. And everything that we do is a result of what our customer wants us to be. That's it.
That's amazing. So as per you, what do you think is the major problem when it comes to fitness? And how can one motivate themselves to change, you know, into a healthy lifestyle?
I think for that, one has to understand the existence, the nature of human beings. You know, we are social beings. That means we live in a society. And without a social structure, we fail to find a meaning to our lives. I mean, all of us, when we assign a meaning to our lives, it is relevant in a societal structure. Remove the society and that meaning is lost. Think about it. You know, the main reason why somebody would purchase a better car is because probably their neighbors had a better car. You know, somebody would live in a better house is probably because their neighbor is living in a better house. I mean, at what point of time people think, okay, this is enough. I don't want more. Right? So this want to do more or do better comes from the society itself. Now, what happens is, what is the cookie at the end of this fitness journey that you get? There's no cookie for you. There's nothing for you. If people say, you know, I want to be fat all my life, that's perfectly fine. Who cares, right? But if five people say, hey, look, I am fit and I think this is better, maybe you should try getting fit. Then the other person is like, okay, maybe these guys are onto something. Maybe the car is actually better. Maybe this car will make me feel better. You know, so fitness in isolation is boring. So you need a community of people who are talking fitness, who are walking fitness, who are constantly motivating people that, hey, we got fit. Let's see how you can do it too. And that is what, you know, differentiates the fitter community also. You know, one of the biggest things that people fail to understand that fitness is not really a journey, a destination. You know, it's more of a habit. For example, taking a shower. Do you really need motivation? Brushing your teeth. Do you really need a motivation? Then why do you need a motivation to work out 15 minutes, 20 minutes, or a motivation to eat healthy food every single day? Who is going to tell these people that, yeah, it's a habit. So I'm one guy. But you need more people to tell people that, hey, it's actually pretty easy to get fit. You're getting my point? So we have to target on behavioral change. If people's behavior has changed, fitness will not become a task for them. It will become basic hygiene. And once you achieve your basic hygiene, you can get on to your other better stuff in life. You know, once you achieve that physical hygiene, you can aim for mental hygiene and then social and financial hygiene. You're getting my point? So fitness is basic. It's neither journey nor destination. It's like brushing your teeth. But somebody has to tell people that.
Amazing. That's amazing. So I believe an entrepreneur's journey is really incomplete without having challenges, without being through tough phases, you know, throughout your journey. So what are some of the key challenges that you would like to highlight and how you were able to overcome them?
Well, this is something I tell everybody, and you know, don't tell anybody. I think my journey was a cakewalk. Literally, last 6 years, the way everything evolved, the way everything panned out, I think there was a of luck factor with me. You know, we did so many mistakes, which somehow turned out well for us. So if you personally ask me if there were any challenges, I'd say no, there were no challenges. Were there any learnings? Absolutely. Every single day I wake up, I find something amazing. I find something interesting, like a problem. And then that problem is something which I solve. And you will always find us, you know, coming up with one solution or other solution. You know, like, we don't do things the typical way. We say, hey, what is your problem? And then we understand that problem. And then we try to solve that problem. It's fun. It's amazing. If somebody asked me, hey, would you do this all over again? I'd say yes, every single time.
So Ria, would you like to take up any more questions?
Hi, sir. So who has been your greatest inspiration, and how would you define success?
Okay, interesting question. My greatest inspiration has been and will always be my dad. I think the main quality of my dad is he's just a good person. You know, if you were a complete stranger and you went to him and he said, would you help me? He'd be like, yeah, please. You know, that's how he is. He's such an amazing person. 2 years back, he randomly broke his arm because he was trying to save a girl from some guy who was harassing her on the street. You know, he broke his arm because that guy was like a 6 foot tall guy and he was harassing a girl early in the morning, 6 a.m. And he went ahead and he started fighting with that guy. So he had a big cane and he broke my dad's arm. But that's how he is. He messes around for other people. That's how good he is. And I'm trying to be that same good person. You know, for me, I think there's a lot of problems in the world. I want this world to be better for my daughter. I believe in goodness. And I'm trying to, you know, make an army of good people. So my dad is my biggest inspiration.
That's lovely. And how would you define success?
Okay. Again, this is a like, different people will have different definitions of success.
Sure.
For me, success can be quantified in terms of how many people you are responsible for making their lives better. How do you say somebody is a successful parent if they successfully raise their child, right? How many kids? One of a successful parent. What do you define as a successful team manager? A guy who manages his team successfully. Number of people is limited. Who do you define as a successful leader or a politician or a prime minister? The number of people who are directly reporting to them or are responsible, you know, and then if those people's lives are getting better, that person becomes a successful leader, right? So for me, successful is the number of people whose lives you are making better. So right now, I think I have made lives of almost 500,000 plus people better. I'd probably have that number much higher. So for me, it's like a you know, unquenchable thirst. I don't think I'd be successful ever.
So what is the advice that you would give to young entrepreneurs who are beginning on their journey?
Solve problems. At the end of the day, entrepreneurship is all about solving problems. If you are solving a problem, then don't worry about the outcomes. You know, even if you fail as an entrepreneur, you know, because you have solved a problem, it is going to affect someone in a positive manner. And that's what you have to care about. You know, solving problems is more important than any other label or tag. Like, don't worry about becoming an entrepreneur. Just be a problem solver. We have so many problems. You know, you don't need entrepreneurs. You just need problem solvers. Becoming an entrepreneur is completely accidental. You know, so just solve a problem. Everything else should be a byproduct of it.
Follow-up questions. Like, in 2013, you've started into this 2020. What has been a change in your personality? What so much success? Okay. You started giving something customers and you become a celebrity, making life changes. What has been a personally change in your lifestyle, family? You know, when you go, people, you know you so much. What have you changed? You know, how have you changed yourself?
I think I'm mentally more stronger, I'm physically more stronger, and I realize that it's a huge responsibility on my shoulders to live up to this image, live up to this reputation that people think, okay, this is this guy. So I think it's a huge responsibility. And it's not easy to affect people's mind in a positive manner. So you have to constantly show them that, guys, this is how you do it. Without showing them, people might want to believe you, but they will not believe you. So you have to deliver results. I cannot preach about problem solving and tell people that, hey, ignore entrepreneurship unless until I become a good entrepreneur and I successfully solve the problem. So I think you have to make promises, but you should also be able to keep them. In the last six and a half years, I think the biggest change and the kind of impact that Twitter has had on my life is that I know myself better. I know who I am. And I definitely think there's a lot more stored in life for me. And just that I have to work even harder, every single day when I wake up first thing in the morning. So it has changed me as a person. It has definitely changed me as a person. It has showed the true meaning of my life, at least.
Basically, getting the people in your team to build such an organization, what has been the challenge to find the right mix of the team, the different skills, and how did you overcome? How do you get the best of the talent to work with you?
Again, like I said, I was extremely, extremely lucky. You'd be surprised to know that majority of the people were hired directly from social media because they left a comment somewhere, because I bumped into somebody at Superstore, because somebody was looking for a job and I was looking for that person. It has happened completely like that. Now we are a much more organized organization with HRs and all those things. In the initial days, I just bumped into people and hired them. So it was so random, and luckily everything worked out. So for example, Sonal Singh, she was one of my clients, and today she's a founding member. And I didn't know that she comes from a very rich educational background. She's a graduate from LSE and all those things. I didn't know about those things. Similarly, Jyoti, she's an ex-IIM. She's ex-Citibank employee. She's a doctor of alternate medicine. So all of them, they came from a different background, but she had just quit her job and she wanted to write articles for Fitter for 10,000 rupees a month. And I did not know her background, but she loved working with Fitter and she used to write articles and she used to donate that 10,000 rupees also. So, it's over a period of time that I realized, okay, she is an IIM graduate. She never told me, and she was working happily. So that's how we met some of the people. Like Rohit was a guy who had his own factory, and he was one of our first clients. When he transformed, he said, boss, mujhe fitness industry mein kaam karna. He left his job, he sold his factory, came to Pune and used to help me sweep the office, make coffee for employees, all those kind of stuff. And he became a co-founder. Then Shashank was an IIM graduate. He was our client. He lost 20 kgs and he sent me at least one dozen emails saying that, JC, I want to work in this organization. And I said, boss, I can't afford you. He said, don't pay me anything. So we started paying him 5,000 rupees a month. He left his 1.5 lakh rupees a month job. He came to Pune, worked on that salary, and now he's getting almost as much salary. So I think there was something about Fitter. There was a connect. We were genuinely changing people's lives. We are still changing people's lives genuinely. And I think people can somehow feel that connection, the honesty, the intent, it's visible. And that somehow draws people in.
Hi, JC. It's very exciting to know about your journey. And fitness also happens to be your passion. And that's how you are transforming many people's lives. So my question is regarding how do you handle competition? Because the space in which you are, it's a mix of organized and unorganized both. So if I want to say there are large organizations like, say, Baba Ramdev's Yoga or Art of Living or Isha Foundation, and then there are structured, organized gyms. Then there are other new age digital health startups like Healthify and your Goqui and many more. So how do you handle that competition?
I simply don't worry about it. I'm a very simple guy. I believe in basic principles, basic universal principles. Do good, be good, and everything good happens to you. That's one of the first principles, right? Second thing is, everything is built on quality. Over decades, or let's say even centuries, how many organizations do we know that did crappy work and are still surviving? None of them. You have companies like Apple who have delivered quality over a period of time. These are businesses which have built over decades of customer service experience and satisfaction. So if there is any organization which is somehow, you know, dealing in people's fear, or an organization which is not doing ethical business, they might be organizations which will survive in a short term. But let's say over a span of 20, 30, 40, 50 or 100 odd years, they will not survive. So for me, it's not about, you know, beating Healthify Me or Cult or any other organization. For me, everything that matters is, do people find us valuable? Do people think, even if there is 1% who finds Twitter useful, I must keep doing it and maintain that same sanity which I have for the last 4.5 years. And that's why we don't advertise. We think advertise is a waste of money. Why don't we use that money to rather improve our services or pay more to the coaches? You know, solving much bigger problems. Now, advertising, you can flush a lot of money. You can advertise on TV. You can get the customers. But if your customer is not happy, if your NPS score is less than, 80. Now, ours is constantly 85 and above. Last month, it was 87. And my team is going to achieve 90% in the coming months. And our customer satisfaction rate is over 96%. So I have told my team that it has to be 99% and more. So these are some of the things that we worry about. Now, competition is something, you know, you'll always have one company or the other.
Correct.
Now, that is very, there's no point worrying about obvious things. So I keep, focusing on what we are doing. And we have a long-term plan. We don't want to be a short-term unicorn and all those things. These things don't appeal to me.
That's great. That's amazing. So if you can also throw some light on, like, we are in a very, very trying circumstances in COVID, where we have found that digital and remote is the new way of living. So how do you address that, like exercises and all those things? We were always thinking that going to gym or going to some other places only means. Now, how do you handle that? You have to work out on your own in your house.
Right. So I have personally set up a small gym, not very big, very, very small gym, which has a bench, which has a couple of dumbbells and a punching bag for my boxing practice. And of course, I was somebody who always thought that, you know, getting fit means working out in a gym, and working out at home is not possible. But I think COVID has shown us that not only is it possible, I think it's even more convenient because I can work out throughout the day. You know, I don't have to go to the traffic. I don't have to worry about, you know, people in the gym. I don't have a possibility of getting infected by somebody else. So I think working out at home is an amazing option. And we realize that what are some of the challenges that people face when they work out at home? First, they don't have equipment. Can we get equipment? Second, what about the personal trainers? You know, personal trainers used to guide them in the gym. Is there a way that people can guide people in a similar manner on the gym? Is it possible through a live video? And we realize not only it's possible, it is almost the same. It's almost the same. You just keep your phone and you keep your trainer can see you and you can see him. And that's it. Like, we are doing this Zoom call. At some point of time, I'm pretty sure people must have thought, yeah, you cannot have business meetings on a Zoom call. It has to be in person. But now that we are realizing, not only is it possible, it's much more efficient, right? So similar thing is happening with the fitness industry. And while most of the people are realizing that now, I think we realized it very early on. And that's why we have been into online fitness since day one. The gym model, any experienced guy takes one look at it and they will realize that this model is bound to fail. So when we're getting into gyms, I was conducting seminars and telling people not to get into gyms. How the whole fitness industry was doomed to fail. You know, it was doomed. It was doomed. It's not something which is a sudden realization. It was doomed. The model was not profitable. At the end of the day, if you're doing business, you have to have profitable returns over a period of time, not just, you know, January or using discount. Your business should be profitable 365 days of entire year. And that's philosophy. And if you are running discounts, if you are burning too much cash, that means that there's something inherently wrong with the business model.
How and when did you come across your first funding?
Okay. So we have been actively involved with investors for quite many years. We just were waiting for the right philosophical fit. the past, we have rejected a lot of funding offers, acquisition offers, because there was not the right kind of philosophical fit. And our philosophy is built on community. So the biggest term was that you're not going to disrupt the community, and you will let us do everything in the way we want. So I think these were some of the things that first we experienced with Y Combinator. Y Combinator was completely indifferent to whatever we were doing, and we felt that, yeah, this does not make sense. So I quit Y Combinator. That was the first round of funding, which we rejected. We didn't take funding from Y Combinator. Luckily, we also got a call from Sequoia Surge at the same time, and I spoke to Rajan, and because he has already worked in companies with a community kind of outlook, it was a natural alignment. And it's been almost 3.5 months throughout the search program. Not once has somebody came out and said, JC, what is going on? What are you guys doing? No pressure whatsoever. They are letting us do the business the way we want. You know, they made a promise that they are going to help us. I made a promise that, you know, whatever money they have invested in, they will get it back. Right? So that's what it is happening. And we are showing them results. And they are supporting us. They are not bothering us. I think that's the perfect fit. When founders are harassed, founders get bothered by investors, that's when productivity goes down, problem solving goes down, innovation goes down, and you know, these fake numbers go down. So in our case, we've been lucky that there's no such thing happening.
So sir, if you had a chance to start your business, like to your career all over again, what would you do things differently?
I think I will, and I'm doing it, by the way. I'm doing it all over again, recreating Fitter, but I'm doing it for kids. I don't want to deal with adults.
So, sir, there's one small question. If somebody wants to get into this healthy lifestyle, and what is the first step they should take? How should they go about it?
I think what they have to do is understand why they need to get fit. Like I said, fitness should not be thought of as a task. You know, if you are physically fit, let me give you an example. Let's say you have a pimple on your face. Throughout the day, what are you thinking about? That pimple. Because you are thinking about that, you don't get time to think about anything else. If that pimple is gone, now you have all the time in the world to think about amazing things that you can build. Physical fitness is like that. If you are physically fit, there is no physical ailment in your body. You have more time to become mentally fit and create things and build things. And this is what I want to show people. And how do you achieve that? By basic eating right and exercising every single day. It does not take much at all. Fitness is not, it's a habit, you know. It does not take more time than taking a shower or going to a beauty parlor. That's how much it takes. You know? That's what we are doing. So don't think of fitness as a luxury or as a task. Think of it as part of your life.
So what is your future goals?
I want to make everybody fit. I want everybody to know what being fit means, and because they will be physically fit, we will have more people building stuff, you know, rather than destroying stuff into vague arguments, you know, because they'll also have more time to think. Today people are reading so much, but they don't understand. You know, they read so much, but they forget the basics. If you are not getting your basics right, that means there is a huge gap. And I think somewhere along the line, these physical ailments are what's bothering people. They are not allowing them to think properly. Once the physical ailments are gone and people think like free mind, they will be able to build and create much more, bigger, better stuff than we are building right now. Plus, we have to do it for our kids. No?
How do you get the customers more acquisition? What has been your acquisition strategy to get more customers and coaches? What is your strategy to get more customers? And how long? Like, is it worldwide you are spread customers? How many customers are in India and outside? What is your pattern right now, revenue pattern? How much you're getting from the within India and outside India?
Right. So right now we have around 68% customers in India and around 32% outside, of which around 18% come from the US. Now, we have not done any kind of marketing. So everything that we have done is completely word of mouth, which means that, you know, you like Fitter. If you get results and you care about somebody else, you will tell them that, hey, faltu mein time waste mat karo, just join Fitter and you will get fit. That's how it has worked. And we have 110,000 plus people who have transformed. So you can see their before pictures and after pictures, and you'd be like, okay, if these guys can do it, we can do it. And these 110,000 people are basically our ambassadors, you know, informal ambassadors who keep talking about the results, who keep talking about how they got fit because of us. So that's our biggest source of, you know, user acquisition. Apart from that, we keep on posting stuff on our social media. We post motivational stories. We post transformation stories. On YouTube also, we keep on posting transformation stories. So these are some of the ways. But we don't do any kind of paid marketing. At least until now, we haven't done it.
How much you charge? Suppose somebody is a guy wants to join it. What is the kind of money he pays? Is everybody same or there is a different, you know, money for the customers to be paying every month for join your program?
Right. So we operate on a freemium model, but there is no difference between what a paid customer gets versus a free customer gets. So even the paid customer and free customer all get knowledge for free, all get diet and training plan for free. The difference between paid training is that you are paying for somebody else's time. So the actual value that you are paying is because somebody is spending their time with you. So the coaches, right? Their technical knowledge is all available for free. But when they spend their time talking to you, that's their real value. So you are paying for somebody's time. Everything else is for free. So we are basically putting the human touch on pedestal. That's what we charge for. We don't charge for anything else.
The coach-wise, the fees will be the different, but every coach has same price.
All coaches have different fees based on their experience, number of clients they have trained, and the fees varies from 6,000 rupees to 20,000 rupees for 3 months.
Okay, suppose I can choose this. If I go to your app, I can choose whichever coach I want, what are the time durations I want, and then I will join in. And the time also I can choose that there is a fixed time.
No. The coaches have been instructed to do their best to make you fit. At the end of the day, if their time is not holding that value for you, then there is no need for you to pay the money, right? So they will do whatever they have to get you fit, change your behavior into a fit behavior, like change your mindset and make sure that you are seeing results which are quantifiable on a scale. So for that, there is no limit to the extent the coach can go up to. Now, from our side, we have an audit team which makes sure that your charts and training charts and everything is uploaded on time. Make sure that the coach is connecting at least once a week on phone. But apart from that, the coaches don't have any limitation on how much they have to interact with you. They can interact as much as they can, as long as the end result is making you fit.
These coaches also, you keep on changing depending upon the, you know, if somebody is not, customer feedback is not, so his value goes down, or what happens actually? You keep on rating.
Yes. So based on ratings, the coaches will go down and up.
Okay.
So there is a result system for the coaches. You can see their public reviews, which are posted by the clients. You can see transformation pictures, which are also posted by the client. So it's a people-driven process. And any coach falls below 4, we give them warnings. And apart from that, if they still don't heed to the warnings, then we off-put them.
Jesse, a quick question. Any plans for using immersive technologies and variables in your programs?
Right. So we have an RX which is actively pursuing this. But again, we realized over a period of time that VR is a very expensive technology. And unless until, so there's a missing component, which is the micro LED displays. So they are flexible displays, which in the right combination of features and lenses can remove the problem of heavy headgear. So it could literally be fit into a normal glass. And unless that happens, the VR technology is not going to become mainstream. Plus, it's also going to become very costly. So how do we bring the same kind of change, but using a low-cost technology? So we started exploring options with what can we do with mobile phones. So now we are getting into active gaming, in which people can play games on mobile phone, but rather than using swipe or, you know, constantly looking at the mobile screen, they can use their body as gestures.